Well, it's very difficult to put my mind into that of General Secretary Xi, who has been, who's taken this decision. But all I'd say is that those who've been sanctioned by the UK have been sanctioned for violating the human rights of Chinese citizens. And those who've been sanctioned by Beijing have been sanctioned for speaking out about the violation of human rights of Chinese citizens. And so it's a pretty extraordinary situation that we find ourselves where some are sanctioned for actions against Chinese citizens and others are sanctioned for defending them.
As a leading voice on the human rights issues lately, what is the motivation, main motivation for you to actually take an interest in the China affairs?
Well, my motivation is pretty simple, which is that I want to have a very close and productive relationship with China and Chinese people around the world. We know that it's possible. We have a very close relationship with Taiwan and Taiwanese people. We have had a very close relationship with Hong Kong and Hong Kongers. And in the past, certainly 20, 30 years, we've had an increasingly close relationship with Chinese people from all across the mainland. So we know very well that Chinese and British people can work together, can live together, can cooperate extremely well. And we also know that Chinese values are hugely important to the UK. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, written for the United Nations, was written by a Chinese diplomat, and those are the values we hold ourselves to. These are not Western values imposed on China. These are Chinese values imposed on the West, quite rightly, because they are extremely important. And I think that these values matter. They matter for me and they matter for people in China.
As you mentioned, the UK and China, just not too long ago, were you know, what many called golden relationship, golden era. What went wrong? Even at that time, China had human rights issues. So what went wrong?
Well, what went wrong, very sadly, is that the Communist Party decided that the openness was going too far and putting its own position at risk. And the reality is the Communist Party is only afraid of one thing, and that's the Chinese people. It's not afraid of America or Britain or anyone else. It's afraid of the Chinese people. And the openness that was coming, the opportunities that were coming, were too great. And that's why you see the clampdown is not so much on the West. It's much more at home. It's Xinjiang, it's Hong Kong, it's Jack Ma. Much more, much, much more than it's on British or American or anybody else.
Many in the Chinese government and even some nationalists in Chinese society say, you know, this is just Western hypocrisy and you just want to stop China rise. Look at, you know, your involvement in war in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in North Africa, so many lives lost, so much suffering. And why, you know, aren't those human rights abuses? Why just point fingers at us?
Well, first of all, many of us have criticized human rights abuses in other parts of the world, and this isn't about that. Secondly, it's not about wanting to stop China's rise. On the contrary, many of us, me included, have been very strong advocates for China's place in the rules-based international system. I've been hugely supportive of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and been looking for ways in which China should rightly have a place in shaping the modern world, because quite obviously, China wasn't there when many of the institutions were formed in the 50s and the 60s, during the Cultural Revolution, during the Great Leap Forward, during the moments when Chinese communist dictatorship murdered millions of Chinese people. It should have been around the table of the international community helping to set the rules, but it wasn't, because Chairman Mao and others were murdering Chinese people. Now, China now has the opportunity to take its place rightfully as one of the great powers, great civilizations of the world. And many of us, me included, would love to, nothing more than to see free Chinese citizens helping to shape the international community for the betterment of everybody. It's exactly what we want.
As a British politician, and you mentioned in previous interviews that these Chinese sanctions on you had really little effect, and because you don't really have any assets in China. But the British and the US and EU sanctions and the Canadian sanctions, do they really have any impact on Chinese officials? They live in China.
Well, actually, one of the things about Chinese society that many of your viewers will know is when I was in Beijing in 2017 and I asked somebody what's the greatest luxury they could have, and I thought they were going to say a Ferrari or a Rolls Royce or a flat or something like that, and they said an American passport. Now, many people in China are hiding money abroad. We know that. Indeed, many of the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party have got accounts in secret jurisdictions abroad, hiding money away from where it could be taken off them by the state. So actually, yes, we do know that sanctions have a direct effect on them because they are stealing money off the Chinese people, hiding it abroad. And then they are using that money to seek opportunities for either their children's education or indeed for travel or just simply to buy luxuries in Paris and Berlin.
So when London, Washington, Ottawa, when Brussels say we freeze your assets, it actually can happen?
Yes.
Has it happened?
Yeah, it has an effect.
And do we know the latest list of four senior officials, for example, from Xinjiang's Public Security Bureau, are they impacted?
I'm not going to go through the detail of each one.
And many also suggested, you know, I've been talking to business people and academics and education professionals. Many of them are worried because, you know, for the City of London, for the university sector, many of them depend on China heavily for trade, for business opportunities. What would the current trend mean for them in the next few years?
Well, I hope very much that the current trend will mean that actually many Chinese students do continue to come to the UK and opportunity is sought for everybody. You know, having Chinese students here studying at our universities is not only welcome, but enriches our universities and enriches many British students in terms of ideas and in terms of opportunity and thinking. But the reality is that we cannot leave ourselves exposed to pressures on academic freedoms or indeed to the undermining of the values of freedom that are absolutely essential to a well-run market and to a well-run university, just simply for a short-term financial advantage. So while it may mean that there are changes, it is absolutely essential we stand up for what matters here and don't simply sell out for a quick shilling.
What if China retaliates in a similar fashion to what they did in, you know, to Australia, for example, to their wine industry, to their iron ores, if they start to sanction British businesses?
Well, the reality is most of the businesses that we're talking about in the UK are businesses to which China exports. So it would be punishing Chinese people, not British people. And most of the universities where we're talking about it, this is where Chinese students to come and study. And if they want to sanction the red princes and princesses of the new rich in Beijing, that would have immediate repercussions on their ability to satisfy the needs of the new middle class.
And why are you calling them red princes and red princesses?
Because they are the rich children of the Communist Party elite.
When you first got elected into the Foreign Affairs Committee, you led the task force on investigating Huawei and 5G and lots of other things. And at that time, the former ambassador, Liu Xiaoming, a Chinese ambassador to China, said openly that if UK chose not to use Huawei or dropped Huawei, there will be consequences. And at this stage, we've decided not to use Huawei. Have we seen the consequences yet?
Well, we are seeing consequences, and of course there are consequences. I mean, you know, we're choosing not to use a provider that is heavily subsidized by the Chinese state. So of course there are consequences, but you've got to decide whether those consequences are consequences you're willing to accept. And you can either believe that the Chinese state really does believe in global communism and is therefore subsidizing its businesses globally, or you can probably more realistically think that actually the Chinese state is trying to secure advantage and therefore is willing to lower the prices beyond the market cost. Now, I suspect it's more the latter.
Recently, the British government finally published this policy paper on defense and foreign policy. In it, China is not, it's named as a competitor, but it's not the top threat. And in your opinion, what is that a good judgment, right judgment?
Well, it's an interesting paper, actually, because the Integrated Review really is all about China, very clearly, and what it actually, when it talks about human rights, it's a coded way of talking about China. When it talks about, climate change, it's talking about China. When it talks about global trade or the tilt to the Asia-Pacific or the Indo-Pacific, as it calls it, it's talking about China. All of these things are talking about China. It's just doing it in a more coded way. Now, I understand why the government does it, but let's not pretend that it's not about China. It is about China.
And at this moment, with all these concerns vis-a-vis relations with China, the City of London and large parts of the UK economy is still pouring money into China side and trying to forge closer relations. And the likes of HSBC and the big banks, the moment China opens up the capital market a little bit, billions flew that way. And from national security point of view, is the government concerned, or are there anything that the government is trying to do?
Well, you'll have to ask the government whether it's concerned or not. That's
okay. But from a policy kind of opinion former side, from a foreign policy side, what's your thought on that?
So my thoughts are that, I would love to see Britain as the natural partner to China in Europe. I would absolutely love to see UK's global markets trading the renminbi as freely as we trade the dollar. But the reality is that the level of control that is put on, for example, foreign exchange, or the level of influence that comes with it, means that we have real problems here. And until we see the level of openness in Chinese companies that we would expect to see in, for example, US companies, or indeed UK or French or German companies, then it does make using our markets very difficult. And that, I'm afraid, is something that is true not just of China, but many other countries around the world. And one of the reasons why we have real problems with that commercial link.
Last question, and there were reports that your personal email and even your home address received suspicious emails before and letters. As your personal address to some, if we have evidence to say these were from, suspected Chinese side, is there anything you want to say to them?
I'm not going to be intimidated. And now I know that what they're trying to do is to intimidate people who have connections to China or to Hong Kong or indeed to other parts. It's not going to work with me. I'm going to call it out because it works with some people, but it isn't going to work with me.